Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to be here to speak to you, and I want to thank the organizers for the invitation to do so. I also want to make a particular thanks to my colleague Anna Lombardia for translating the slides, which you will see in Spanish, I hope. But I will continue to speak in English, so I guess you can listen to the interpretation on your headphones if that's what you will help. So I'm talking about a research effort which has been led from the Guildhall School of Music and Drama in London, which began in 2010, and I've led most of the investigations in that project. And the project has only been possible because of a large number of both internal and external collaborators who together to date have produced 15 publications from the project. And on your seats, there is a sheet of the full references for what's available in the public domain. And here, I won't, of course, read them out, but this is the public acknowledgement of all my colleagues at Guildhall, outside Guildhall, and also funders who made this work possible. So the research question, which has motivated everything really that we've been doing, is a very simple one. What do audiences want from live concerts? And what opportunities and challenges are there for professional, which usually means conservatoire-trained musicians, in providing what audiences want? Well, why is that an important question for research? I think it's very well known in this room that there has been a steady decline in audiences for live classical music over the last 25 years. The best and most comprehensive data, I think, exists in the United States through the National Endowment of Arts periodic surveys, which ask a stratified sample of the population exactly the same questions every time about what they go to. There's also some comparable data in the UK organized by the Arts Council taking part periodic surveys. So I think most of what I say is more informed by those surveys. It may be different in other countries, or it may not. But what these surveys show is that the decline in attendance to classical music is specific. It's specific to classical, symphonic music, chamber music, also to opera and to ballet. Attendance at other forms of live music have not shown a decline over the same period. So in pop music, in theater, in museum and gallery attendance, there has been no decline over the past 25 years. In fact, in some areas, there's actually been an increase. So this is a problem quite specific to classical music. And as already previous speakers have alluded to this morning, it's an aging audience. So the decline in attendance is concentrated in people under the age of 50. And since future live audiences are the reason why conservatoires primarily exist, then this is an existential problem for conservatoires such as the one where I work, and clearly also an existential problem for symphony orchestras. My colleague Miranda Ford at the Guildhall, who's a sociologist, and I have been trying to explore some of the big cultural shifts which might underlie this change. And we see a disconnect. We see a disconnect between the formation of professional musicians, which determines how they comport themselves in the public arena, and that comes from the Paris Conservatoire model, which has been the dominant model now for more than 100 years. And it specifies a traditional type of audience engagement based around the preservation of a canon of accepted masterpieces and the duty of the musician to be faithful to the composer's intention in conveying that canon to an audience. And that then puts the audience in the position of being a kind of humble observer of greatness which is mediated to them by the composers. So there's a clear hierarchy: composer at the top, performer in the middle, audience at the bottom. But in terms of contemporary culture, there's a very different ethos. Younger people are not very interested in hierarchies, and our conclusion of looking at what it is that young people might more want is that in the absence of deference for cherished works and composers, younger audiences are rather seeking a relationship with the performer, and perhaps a more equal relationship than implied in the Paris Conservatoire model. Now, in exploring this issue in greater depth, we devised a simple conceptual tool for describing live events from an audience engagement perspective. And the purpose of this tool is to be, first of all, intellectually grounded in what we actually know from research and scholarship, but also quite simple to grasp, capable of elaboration and therefore capable of improvement. This is not a final model, this is a beginning, but that it should be practically implementable and offer options to artists and artist managers rather than dictating any particular activity. And finally, that such a model should be testable and refinable both through artistic experience and also scientific research. So this conceptual tool specifies four dimensions on which live events, any live event, can vary. The first dimension is established repertoire versus new repertoire, and in what proportion. The second dimension is the predictable or unpredictable nature of what happens. The third dimension is the degree of impersonality or personal engagement that is manifested in that event. And the final dimension is the degree of passivity or activity that is open to the audience. And I want just to briefly take you through each of these before moving on to some research studies. So by established or new work, well, established means the well-tried repertoire, usually by dead composers, and this is the staple of most symphony and chamber programs, as already we heard this morning. New means recent work or unfamiliar work, much by living creators. And if we look around at the cultural scene as a whole, it would be pretty clear that theaters and galleries include more new work on average than concert halls do. The second dimension is predictable versus unpredictable. In a predictable program, many of the details, if not all of the details, are fixed in advance. And there is a conventional, perhaps might even say stereotypical presentation, for example, in the way that the musicians dress, their etiquette on the stage, the layout of the stage. All of these things can be very predictable and often are in classical concerts. More unpredictable things happen when, for example, there is flexible programming. So, for example, in most popular concerts or jazz concerts, there isn't a program specified in advance. You go to hear the performer, and they decide what they're going to perform in the moment. There are also possibilities for unconventional presentation of things like staging, lighting, the arrangement of performers in space, and so on, which by and large classical concerts are quite cautious in exploring, and other art forms are more adventurous quite often. The next dimension is impersonal versus personal in relation to what the performer does, the performer role, the performer presentation. So in the impersonal mode, a performer stays inside a quite strict or restricted role, very often with restricted bodily and facial expressions and limited interaction between performers and audience. Some people talk about a glass screen, that in many classical concerts, it is almost as if the audience are watching something happening on a screen because there is very little traffic across that screen. In the more personal situation, then performers adopt a more emotional and communicative stance. They may be talking to the audience, smiling, the whole range of bodily gestures. Maybe the clothing also communicates certain things about the person of the performer. And finally, passive versus active. So this is about the role or the stance of the audience. In the passive role, audience is very much in the role of humble recipient, still and silent, and in a sense subject to the authority of others, that an audience has to behave itself according to rules which were not laid down by the audience themselves, but by others. In the active mode, audiences are allowed, or they take for themselves, more agency in the room, participating through movement, through vocalization, through spontaneous signals of approval, or indeed spontaneous signals of disapproval. And we would argue that in general, compared to other arts, classical music and classical concerts are more established, predictable, impersonal, and passive compared to what else you could go and see on the live stage. And this creates a response, certainly in younger audience members. I'd like to refer very briefly to an excellent study, a doctoral dissertation by my former colleague, Melissa Dobson. And the centerpiece of her research was taking a group of young adults to classical concerts. And these young adults had never been to a classical concert before. So she gave them their first experience of a classical concert and then recorded their response. One young person who was taken to the London Symphony Orchestra in its home concert hall in London, the Barbican, said in the interview afterwards, "In the Barbican, it was like they were playing, and the feeling was like, if we were not there, it would have been exactly the same." Yeah? So this young person felt completely invisible and unrecognized in the room. So the question is, how can we engage contemporary audiences in deeper and fuller ways? And our working hypothesis, which is constantly being tested against actual experience, is that we can do that by shifting our concerts along any of these dimensions. In other words, from established to new, from predictable to unpredictable, from impersonal to personal, and from passive to active, according to your artistic possibilities, what's feasible, and what do you want. So how are we testing this model by our research? Well, we have an approach which tries to demonstrate a range of possible approaches to these dimensions, a range which is accessible for those performing or those putting on concerts. We've concentrated on quite a large number of short-term and low-cost projects to spread our endeavor more widely, but also because of the funding constraints, which sadly constrain research these days. It's very difficult to raise money, big money, for research projects. So we go with small money. Each of our projects involves at least one musician and one trained researcher in a productive collaboration. If we can't find a musician who wants to do the project, then the project doesn't happen. And the aim is to stimulate musicians and music organizations to try new things and to see researchers as allies and supporters in that endeavor. And finally, for researchers, this is about trialing possible alternative modes of engagement for us as researchers, not staying inside our own intellectual ivory towers, but going out and meeting the real world through research which is applicable, relevant, and one might argue, socially responsible. So up until this time, we have actually got engaged with eight separate projects. I've just listed them there for completeness. They're in date order. I won't have time to talk about them all in the time that's been given to me, but if there are questions on any I didn't mention, then maybe there'll be time for that. So I'm now going to go and pick sample projects which address, in turn, each of these four dimensions that I mentioned. So first of all, looking at some research on established versus new work. Now, in one way, this is quite a difficult issue for us researchers, because very often, classical musicians and the organizations that they work for have already committed to specific repertoire before they involve us as researchers. I've not been asked to help any artist or artistic organization with their repertoire choices. So the issue we have been invited to work on is how to deepen understanding and enjoyment of the new music that musicians do program. And that's in the context, which has already been mentioned a couple of times this morning, of audience resistance to new music, particularly those who are very comfortable with the traditional overture, concerto, symphony sandwich, which was eloquently talked about earlier today. So three of our projects address this, and I'm going to have time to talk about two of them. The first one I want to talk about is a relatively recent project, not yet published, so you're the first public audience actually to hear the full story, or one of the first audiences. This is a project led by my colleague working in the USA, Andrea Halpin, but with some UK collaborators, Julian Anderson, the composer, Daniel Mullen-Siefen, and Chloe Chan, psychologist at Goldsmiths University of London. And this is around the practice of repeating the same work twice in a concert. Now, of course, spontaneous encores have long been a documented feature of live concerts. But I'm not talking about encores. I'm talking about planned and programmed repetitions. Now, these are more rare, but they have been featured in public concert programs. And we know, as psychologists, because there has been quite a lot of work in this area, that in studies using recorded music, repeated listening to the same piece of music increases your liking for that music and also deepens your understanding of it, as you would think pretty obvious, but the data is there. It's very firm. What hasn't been researched much is whether this translates to live performance, where, of course, two performances are not identical. They can differ in either subtle or more major respects. Just some quick examples of such programming that has come to our attention. Stravinsky adopted this procedure quite frequently, particularly later in his life, and particularly in the shorter of his pieces, concerts conducted by Robert Craft, and Robert Craft continued that practice after Stravinsky's death, in deference to Stravinsky's wishes. In fact, in some cases, Stravinsky withheld permission for his work to be performed at all unless it was played twice. So he had quite strong views that this would be beneficial. In Britain, the composer-conductor Oliver Nussand has included repeats of a wide range of composers, mainly contemporary, in his concerts. Carter, Stravinsky, and famously, in 2005, Webern's five orchestral pieces in a concert by the London Sinfonietta. I say famously because there's a rather amusing anecdote connected to that concert, which is that there was a celebrated music critic of a newspaper in the room. Nussan played the piece twice, and the music critic wrote of the rudeness of the audience of applauding halfway through the piece, that the critic didn't actually notice that the piece had been repeated twice. A more recent example comes from a UK festival called the New Music Biennial, which is, as the title describes, happens every 2 years and new work is commissioned, and the format for each concert is that it focuses on one work. The work is heard once, then there's a panel discussion involving the composer, some of the performers, maybe some musicologists, and then the work is performed again. And both the first and the second performance are broadcast on the national radio, the British Broadcasting Corporation, BBC. So the practice exists. But what doesn't exist is any formal assessment of the impact on an audience. Does it actually have any benefits? And that's what our research was designed to assess. So we have been systematically assessing audience response to pre-announced repeats. And we've done this at two live concerts in the Guildhall School in 2014, and also in a laboratory situation using one of the recordings from the New Music Biennial. In the case of the Guildhall School concerts, these were complete short compositions, Varese's Ionization and two student compositions lasting between 4 and 6 minutes each. In the case of the New Music Biennial, the piece that was chosen was by a composer Lau, and it was a 15-minute piece from which a 4-minute instrumental extract was extracted because we didn't want to go into the whole issue of words, which is a whole other area. After each performance of the piece, audience members were asked to rate the performances and their reactions to that on 7-point scales. There were two affective or emotional measures. One was, I enjoyed the piece, and the other one was, I would like to hear the piece again in the near future. And then there were two cognitive ratings. I felt I understood the piece, and if played some excerpts from the piece tomorrow, I'm confident I'd be able to recognize them. The affective and cognitive pairs went very closely together. There was no real difference between the answers to those questions. So in the scoring, we collapsed those into just two scores, an affective score and a cognitive score. And what you can see on this, I hope, quite simple table is, first of all, the effective scores of the first performance, then the effective scores of the second performance, then the cognitive scores of the first performance, and the cognitive scores of the second performance. Both separated for concerts, and then totaled or averaged at the bottom. And what we can see, with one exception, is that there was a statistically significant improvement in liking and also in the sense of understanding the piece. So it actually helps people to hear the piece twice. The only case where there was not a significant difference, although it still did rise, was the Varese. But I think what you can see is that people liked it quite a lot to begin with, so there wasn't much room left for a great deal of improvement in liking. So to summarize that, our data show that repeating a piece, an unfamiliar piece, a piece that an audience member will not have heard before, increases the enjoyment and understanding of that piece. And we also found that this effect occurs both for people who are familiar with contemporary music and those who are unfamiliar with it. It doesn't depend on your degree of familiarity. Although those who were familiar with this type of music liked it more. And that, I think, is probably to be expected. But the point is that even people who didn't like it very much at the outset liked the second hearing more than the first. And that may have some implications for thinking about how you program new music in concerts. Moving on, because time is not on our side. Second study, also very new. In fact, this study, we don't have very much data yet. This is about music which has been expressly written and commissioned for the audience to play a role in the performance, other than listening. This is an ongoing research project led by my colleague Jutta Töhle of the Max Planck Institute for Empirical Aesthetics in Frankfurt. And what is happening in that project is we're observing the impact of pieces which are composed with parts for the audience to play. They play instruments, they make sounds, and also in some of the contexts they move. So this is looking directly at repertoire to be more, in some sense, interesting and enticing for audience. But it also is about bringing the audience from a more passive role into a more active role. The artistic details, there are two world premieres involved here by composers Christian Mason and Huang Ruo. And these works have been done four times, or will have been done four times. They were performed by the London Sinfonietta in London in October, then by the Ensemble Modern in Frankfurt, also in October. They've just been performed in Amsterdam by Asko Schoenberg, and they will be performed next month in Porto by the Remix Ensemble. And we're collecting data at all of those concerts, because the contexts, including the room and the environment, are quite different in those four places. So in terms of audience engagement, what actually happened? Well, there were rehearsals or warm-ups before the concert so that audience members were shown what to do and given the chance to practice it. In some cases, in the concert itself, in other cases, at advanced sessions. Then during the concert, they would perform as directed by visual and sonic cues. Immediately after the concert, there was a questionnaire. And also, we are involving the composers, the artists, and the management in interviews about their perceptions of how this went. Here is the publicity, at least for one of the concerts, the London Sinfonietta concert, which says, two groundbreaking commissions by Christian Mason and Huang Ruo give you the chance to perform world premieres with the London Sinfonietta. No musical experience is needed. Glass bottles, bowling balls, tinfoil, harmonicas, and whispers will be your instruments. The questionnaire had a number of quantitative measures with 1 to 7 scales. I enjoyed this piece. I got a clear sense of how this piece is put together. I feel the performance was well done. And then something about themselves. I would consider myself a musician. I'm familiar with contemporary classical music such as played tonight. There were also some open measures where we invited people to write whatever they would like. What was the best thing about the performance for you? What, if anything, did you not like or find difficult about the performance? What is your feeling about attending a similar event again? Now, the data collection and analysis is still underway, but what I can tell you is that the audience was highly motivated in the sense of highly motivated for the research. In London, 106 people stayed behind after the concert and spent quite a long time filling in the questionnaire, and some of the responses were very long. And in Frankfurt, even more stayed behind, 142. And in both cases, the average ratings for enjoyment was high. It was over 5.5 in the London data. However, because the rooms were so different and the choreography of the performance was different in different contexts, that's an impact that we still have to evaluate. And maybe at a future event, I can bring this back to you. But I think what's really interesting about this is that here is a set of ensembles, international ensembles for contemporary music, who are thinking very deeply about ways of bringing audience members more in to the performance rather than being outside looking at it. Let me now move to the second dimension of predictable versus unpredictable. Only one of the studies that I've been involved in has centrally examined or focused on this dimension. And this is a pilot study of the impact of improvisation within the classical repertoire. And this is a study led by my colleague David Dolan, who is a pedagogue at the Guildhall School, who heads a center for classical improvisation, one of the very few in Europe. The other colleagues mentioned are scientists at Imperial College at London. And this is published, and the details are on your handout. It's in a free online journal, so you can consult it without cost. For that reason, I'm going to run through it quite quickly. So what do we mean when we're talking about classical improvisation? Well, first of all, in the context of the model that I began this presentation with, it's a direct challenge to the Paris Conservatoire model and the sacrosanct nature of the composer's score, because it moves back to the recovery of a lost 18th century and 19th century standard performance practice, where musicians would not invariably, but very, very often, improvise and extemporize on the given score. And David, in his work, describes the improvisatory approach as spontaneous, in the moment, musically informed variation in expressive parameters of timing, loudness, and timbre, along with actual new notes. So you don't have to do new notes in order for it to be improvisatory. It's about the in-the-moment decisions that you take. And the belief is, both in terms of practice, but also informal observations of reception, that this is an authentic and powerful device for contemporary audiences. But because there are so few practitioners of this art, it's rarely available to live audiences. And the hypothesis which David put forward is that improvisation and improvisational state of mind during the performance is associated with heightened musical experience in terms of both the performer's engagement and also the audience response. And this hypothesis arose directly out of David Dolan's musical practice, and we, the scientists, were enlisted in order to help interrogate it. So this is very much a musician-led project, not a scientist-led project. And in that respect, it's gratifyingly unusual. The details, this was a live concert in 2012 by a trio. And in the short concert, they performed five pieces each twice. And one of the performances was a conventional, prepared, but still expressive performance, and the other performance was an improvised performance. But the audience did not know which order the improvised and the prepared pieces would be coming in, and they were not told. They were just told, you will hear each piece twice. Even I, who was in the audience, didn't know which order it was. Only David Dolan and the players knew. And questionnaires were put out to all the audience members, rating their experience. And also, some of the audience members and the players had brain measurements made. I'm not going to talk about that because it's not my expertise, but I could try and answer questions on that if people are interested in the brain data. I'll concentrate on the verbal data. So after each performance, the audience were asked to rate for the degree that they detected or experienced each quality using a rating scale of 0, none, not at all, to 5, totally or completely. And the five dimensions were improvisatory in character, innovative in approach, emotionally engaging, musically convincing, and risk-taking. And the next slide shows the average response in the non-improvised and improvised performances. And as you can see, the gray bars on the right are the improvised data. In all cases, the improvised performance produced significantly higher responses from the audience. And they were also invited to comment on their experience. And a typical comment for a prepared performance was pleasantly played, though tame and conventional. And a comment for the improvised pair, or a half of the pair. It was very intense. Musically, a lot happened. The musicians were really making music and telling a story together. So this study, I think, allows us to conclude that reintroducing the lost art of classical improvisation can enhance audience experience, making for a stronger engagement between performers and audience. And it's well known to people who are aficionados of other improvisatory forms, such as jazz, that because every event is unique and unrepeatable, people say, you had to be there. You had to be in the room, otherwise, it was lost forever. Okay, moving quickly on to the third dimension, impersonal versus personal. So several of our studies have looked at this variable, but only one was able to assess the impact of that dimension in depth, and this was in an audience development initiative with a UK-based professional chamber orchestra. And the chamber orchestra concerned was the Britain Sinfonia, and this was a collaborative study with my colleagues from Guildhall, Henna the Gaunt and Karen Wise, and also a musicologist from Cambridge, John Rink. The artistic context, Britain Sinfonia is one of the UK's professional chamber orchestras. A few years ago, it took up a new residency in our conservatoire's Milton Court, which is a newly built concert hall for chamber music and chamber orchestras. I believe it seats 800 people. It's next to the Barbican Arts Centre, for those of you who've been to London. And as you may know, the Barbican Centre itself only has a 2,000-seater auditorium for classical music, so that it doesn't have something of that a more intimate size. And the main research question was, how are audience members' experience of new work affected when they participate in enhanced opportunities to participate in a rehearsal and organized discussions involving composers and players? In order to study this, we recruited a group of what we've called audience consultants. They agreed to attend two concerts in the season and attend associated pre- and post-concert events and a feedback seminar a couple of weeks after the second concert. Some of these were regular Britain Sinfonia London attenders recruited from their mailing list. 22 of these people were Guildhall students recruited through departments in the school who also attended a pre-project orientation session to look at the pedagogical potential uses of this for them as developing performing musicians. And also 35 regular attenders at the Britain Sinfonia's residency in Cambridge. It has three residences around the country. I'm only going to talk about one of the concerts today because of time. I'm talking about this concert here on the left. And it took place in both Cambridge and then a couple of days later in London. And the Cambridge audience attended an open rehearsal, a pre-concert talk, and then filled in a research questionnaire afterwards. The London audience attended an open rehearsal, attended a post-rehearsal discussion between the composer, the general manager, and some of the performers, and filled in the same research questionnaire. I think I've already described roughly what the process is, so for time I will run over that and just show you what the program looked like in the Britain Sinfonia promotion. The work which was highlighted was the Britain Serenade for tenor, horn, and strings. But there was a whole range of works, primarily contemporary and 20th century. And what was interesting about this particular concert, the program was conceived as an unbroken sequence with no applause between the items. And through careful choreography and lighting, musicians moved on and off for different pieces to give the impression of a kind of seamless movement through the different pieces, culminating in the Britain Serenade for tenor, horn, and strings, which was seen as the kind of the main work. But there was a world premiere by the composer Judith Weir, as well as other works which were likely to be new and unfamiliar to this audience. Here's some data from this study. First of all, reactions to the open rehearsal itself, which was, of course, the final rehearsal before the concert on the day. A majority of respondents said that they gained an insight into the way an ensemble works. They gained an opportunity to see how performers collaborate and relate to one another, an opportunity to gain insights into the artist's creative process, and an opportunity to gain deeper insights into the music. It makes the concert experience richer and more rewarding. But what I'd like to just do is delve a little more deeply into the reactions that they gave to this in their free written responses, because these are the ones which really personalize it. It was very noticeable that there were warm human dynamics between the players, the democracy and collaboration that was shown on the stage during the rehearsal, and the leadership style of the violinist who actually was kind of curating this particular concert. There was the appreciation of the process of putting a performance together, that is to say, an understanding, a deeper understanding of the care that musicians put into that, and knowing that everybody on stage had made a contribution. There was a sense of demystification or humanization, because things did go wrong in the rehearsals, things had to be fixed, discussions had to be had about do we do it this way or do we do it that way. And it was very reassuring and humanizing to audience members to see that actually professionals are human beings too. Not everything about attending a rehearsal was positive for all people. The acoustics of the room were such that it was quite difficult to hear some of the things that the performers said to each other. And the last thing we wanted to do was mic the performers up and make the rehearsal into a performance. That would have really destroyed their process. And some audience members also said it was a little late in the process to really get a sense of them working at this piece, because by the day of the concert, you're just fine-tuning details. What I'm going to do, because of time, I can come back to some of this, is just to say that in terms of the impact that audience members felt this had on their concert experience, they were very, very clear and eloquent. There were three main themes in terms of the impact of being invited behind the scenes to the experience of the concert itself. The first of these themes was orientation, that is to say they were more familiar with the works and the process and the artistic thinking because of having attended the rehearsal, and that helped. They were able to connect more with music making as a process rather than as a finished product. And finally, they were able to connect much more personally with the people involved, get a sense of who they were, their ethos, their commitment to the music, their commitment to each other, their passion for the music. I'm just going to read you one of the many useful quotes that this study provided. And I'm just running through to get the Spanish up there. I think that's the right one. Yes. I'm just going to read this to you because it's so telling. I found the rehearsal interesting. It made the performers seem more human in the sense of fallible and subject to variation and imperfection. This made the occasion of the concert feel more unique and special. In fact, I felt more empathy with the performers, with them being less like untouchable, perfect gods, and because of that, more involved with the whole event. The pre-concert talk was interesting as it explained the rationale behind not clapping until the end and opened up the process of Judith Weir's composition process. For some reason, when a composer is alive, one can listen to a piece in a more critical way, and one is less of the impression that that was the only way that piece could ever be, but rather it is a single option among many various alternatives that the, again, more human composer could have chosen. Hearing Judith in person emphasized this effect. Now, I've already been signaled that I'm over my time, so all I'm going to do very quickly is say that there is another study, which I haven't got time to talk about unless someone asks me to talk about it, on the relation of passive versus active in terms of the audience stance. But what I can say is that this is a series of studies about putting on post-concert events with a different twist, because we're all familiar with these post-concert events, but this particular way of doing it is that we worked with the artists to generate questions for the audience. In other words, they treated the audience as a consultative group to give answers to questions that the artists had about the impact of what they'd just done. So it turned the tables. The artists ask the questions, the audience answers them, which isn't the normal way it's done. And one of the things we found from that study is that audience members and performers raise the level of their attentiveness. Performers give more attention to the preparation and rehearsal process when they know that there are certain questions that they're going to pose to the audience. Audience come into the room more attentively when they know that they're going to be asked something about the performance afterwards and they're going to be put on the spot. So what was also found was that the level of engagement from the audience was higher when they had volunteered to become consultants, which is not a role which is normally given to audience members. I just want to finish with something which may not appeal to everybody, but in many of the organizations that I've been involved with, we're expected to define visions, outcomes, and aims as three levels of activity. And I just had a go at trying to see what that vision might be in terms of this audience engagement we're all striving for. So the vision might be a society in which professionally performed live art music enriches all sectors of that society and where the value that this brings is explicitly recognized and understood in the public mind. And how would we get to that vision? Well, through an outcome, perhaps, where personal, institutional, and artistic practice, which powerfully connects professional live art, music, and performance to the growth and development needs of those who attend. And for me and the people I work with, that means connecting artistic, scientific, and institutional resources to empower advanced musicians to develop, document, and evaluate artistically effective innovations which engage their audiences in deeper and fuller ways. And if we can have achieved a little bit towards all of that, we will have been very satisfied that our work has not been wasted. Thank you very much.